more people
Okay,
join.
event is getting recorded. So I believe we can start. People would be joining in on the fly. That's how. But yeah, so we are 3 minutes into it. So yeah. Welcome everyone to this edition of Alum Cafe series organized by Alumni Association, IIT Kanpur Bangalore chapter. So we welcome Adhiteshwar Seth. So he is my senior from Hall 3, same hall as me, and he's also he also belongs to same department as me, computer science and engineering. So we are very welcome, Adhiteshwar, and he has been doing pretty interesting work in social sector, apart from being a renowned faculty at IIT Delhi. So warm welcome, and would hand over to Vikrant. So thanks Vikrant for moderating this, not moderating, really hosting this session. This is a fireside chat. So thank you, and over to you.
Thanks, Pratmesh. So hello everyone, good evening. We're going to talk about technology and social development, a complicated relationship. And before we begin, let me just introduce myself. I'm Vikrant, class of 2002 IIT Kanpur, part of the Alumni Association Bangalore chapter of IIT Kanpur. So thanks for the Alumni Association for hosting this event. I've seen Ramani for a long time, almost 10 years now, from the beginning. And I remember asking almost at that time a question to Adhiteshwar about, why do you want to recreate a Facebook-like social media for the bottom of the pyramid in India? And I think a decade later, during the COVID pandemic, I think the answer became clear. As the pandemic ravaged India, the digitally savvy were able to use Facebook, Twitter for SOS calls, arranging help and helping others. But for the vast majority of people in India, there was no way to these platforms were not available to them. And Grammoney was able to leverage its technology to let the migrant workers, the marginalized group, reach out, raise SOS calls, share information with them, raise awareness about vaccination. And I think that answer was really illuminating. I hope in this talk, we'll be able to take away some of these learnings on how to think about technology and social development. So Dr. Adhiteshwar Seth is the rare engineer who straddles both technology and social development, which is a very rare skill, I would say. He completed his PhD from University of Waterloo. He's an associate professor at IIT Delhi in the CS department, computer science department, and he runs the Appropriate Computing Technology for Development research group at IIT Delhi. And he co-founded Gamvani in 2009. The way we'll run this meeting is we'll discuss for about 20-25 minutes some key questions to illuminate. Bring out the core issues, and then we'll open the platform for Q&A. We already have received some questions, and we'll look at some live questions as they come in. Hopefully, it will be interactive. And with that, let's start the questions. So, Hadi, the first question is really, how did you get started into thinking about Gramvani? What motivated you to start Gramvani, and what problems are you trying to solve?
Yeah, thanks, Vikrant, and thanks to the Alumni Association for having me. It's really exciting to reconnect after so many years with so many people. Great. So yeah, so Vikrant, like you said, you asked me many many years back that why was I trying to create something like a Facebook for rural areas? And indeed, so the story of Gramani was even before that. And you were actually a part of the whole journey. in fact, of how many of this came together. Because, so you remember, we've gone on so many treks in the mountains. And it was really on one of these hikes, so when I had gone off for my PhD to Canada, and when I came back to India on one of my vacations, and we were trekking through these remote mountains, remote villages. So that's really when the stark contrast really hit me. So until then, in my PhD, I was doing regular technology-based research, really, trying to work on computer networks, building faster networks, and so on. But it was actually one of these trips that made me really think that how can we apply our skills for benefiting some of these areas which are completely disconnected. So that was really the start, the germ of the idea in some sense. I worked on many of these issues during my PhD. And Gramani was sort of the culmination just when I finished and we started in 2009. So the key problem that we were really trying to solve is that we had seen how the digital media, how the internet had really empowered many of us who had access to it. And we had used it in many different ways. So one of some of the most inspiring uses were improvement in governance, which sort of resonated with me. That when people had the power to create content, to express themselves, to take photographs of human rights abuses or other problems and post it on the internet. Social media was coming up at that time. So posting videos on YouTube, we used to have Orkut back then. Facebook had just about started. So, and these had really, now of course social media has gotten a bad name because of all the misinformation, disinformation that also happens over there. But back then it was really seen as a democratizing medium, something that was going to remove gatekeepers and something that was going to give power to the people, put power in the hands of people so that through which they could really voice themselves and assert their rights. So that was really the genesis that in areas that did not have the internet, how could we work on some of these issues? And so we started, we made many, many mistakes. But finally, some of the things that really came together was, one was the use of voice. The idea over here was that there are literacy challenges. People may not have the internet, or even if they do, they may not be able to use it on their own because of literacy, because of text-based nature of interaction. But voice was that common denominator, which could be accessible to anybody. And around the same time, mobile phones were proliferating. There was a very rapid growth. And these were basically mobile phones for voice calls, not for data. So one of the innovations basically that we built along the way at Gramvani was to use IVR systems, interactive voice response systems. So this is basically, you would know, this is what you get in a call center, where you can call and you get this automated prompt for press one for this, press two for this, and so on. But really, it's just a simple call. So the systems that we built actually were that people could give a missed call to our server and the server would cut the call and call them back. So in this way, there was no cost for the people, for the users to use it. And over this, they could listen to audio messages or they could also record their own audio message. So this was really the most powerful thing because we essentially enabled people to record messages where they could ask questions on agriculture, let's say, or they could record a local news about some government scheme or some problem that they're facing. They could ask for help. So in fact, you mentioned about COVID relief. So some of these systems became very effective because people were able to call and they were able to record problems they were facing with access to food, access to cash, or especially during the second wave around emergency, health emergencies where they needed transportation or other help. What the platform allows us to do then is that these messages, we have a team of moderators who can review these voice messages that are being recorded and then take some action. So the action could be in terms of providing immediate help to people, passing on their message to maybe some other NGO who could help them. Or the place where the media element becomes most important is that these messages can also be posted back on the IVR so that other people can listen to it. So this is really the key which drove where you can draw the similarities with Facebook. because it's enabling people to now voice themselves. And these messages are can now be heard by thousands of other people. So that gives them a very strong feeling of empowerment. Because now they can see that, well, if I'm talking about problems, let's say my ration shop is not opening. The dealer just opens the shop for 3-4 days in a month. And even when I go, sometimes my Aadhaar biometric may not work, or there might be other issues. I might not, whatever are the full units of food given to me, the trader might not give me the full units of food. So now you can actually call into the system and you can report this issue. And this issue gets published, which means that there is now a lot of pressure on the ration dealer because somebody is actually making this allegation. And this allegation is verified, right? So it's verified by a team of volunteers that we have, and it is then published on the platform. So it's really about essentially reversing the power equations in the local community by empowering those who so far have not had a voice to actually put out. Right? So it's not just with ration dealers, but with government schemes, with issues with local telecom providers, banks, so many, right? Private and public services. So there's a very strong social accountability role that the platforms are able to serve. Plus, of course, it's very useful for information sharing. So people now are able to talk about local news, local issues, even if it is a local cricket match or a kabaddi match, right? The newspapers don't carry that information, but people want to hear all that. So it's a platform for cultural expression. So that's really the kind of participatory media. So we describe it as voice-based participatory media platforms that Gramani has now been running for many, many years. And so we do it on through IVR systems. We also have a mobile application now, where again, it's the same voice-based nature, which makes it more accessible. So you don't have to type anything, right? Just speak into, even if you have a smartphone, you can have the app and speak into it. And through that, you can create discussions, you can share information, knowledge, ask for help, ask questions, comment on public schemes, comment on what's not working. And we then, so we're basically just providing this infrastructure to communities through which they can really empower themselves. Yeah.
So this is, I think, what Slate, while covering Gramani recently, had called the missed call revolution in a way. To allow the people to dial back.
Vikrant, could you speak a bit loudly?
Maybe now?
Yeah, it's better, yeah.
So this is what Slate magazine, while covering Gramani, had recently called it as the missed call revolution.
Right. Right.
For people to reach out and assert their rights, as you put it.
Right. Exactly.
Can you also comment on where all Gramani is present in India and abroad? How widespread is the usage? Can you comment on that?
Yeah, no. So the we're present in almost 12 states in India. So of course, it's not to say that we're available everywhere in the state, but in several districts, especially in rural central India, in Bihar, Jharkhand, MP, and UP, we have a strong presence in Tamil Nadu also and in Karnataka. So those are some of our main areas, but many of these platforms are also used by migrant workers. So we get calls from them also, irrespective of where they're traveling. Then our model has also been adopted by several organizations in other countries also. So some years back, we ran this in affiliation with some radio stations in Afghanistan. We're also working in Ethiopia, where the same platform is used by physically disabled people. So so the idea is that the technology is the same, the model is the same, where you can call and you can discuss and share information. But it's used in many different contexts, like with visually impaired people and physically disabled people, where they can share information and thoughts. So even things like what's the best mobile phone model for me if I'm a visually impaired people. So they're able to exchange tips. So in that way, we're working with trade union partners in labor rights. We're working in the health and nutrition space where self-help groups use the platform to share and learn about maternal health and nutrition practices. We're using it in the immunization space. And then, of course, governance and accountability is one of our main uses across all these areas.
So coming back to the main thesis of the talk, right? You put it as technology and social development, a complicated relationship, right? So why do you call that? You know, it's a difficult couple.
Yeah, it is. So this is really where when we started, right? We were basically a team of engineers, and we thought that, well, yeah, we're cool people. We'll build cool technology. We'll build it on IVR. And I mean, we figured that part out. And then we said that, yeah, people will just be able to use it and it will change the world. But it's way more complicated than that. And also, while ensuring that it doesn't lead to undesirable outcomes, it doesn't lead to any harm in the communities. So, for example, even though IVR itself, we might say that it's more inclusive than, let's say, the internet, right? That anybody can use it. But once we started working on the ground, we realized that there's a wide spectrum, even in terms of people being able to understand even what IVR is. Even this concept that they're talking to a machine at the other end is alien to many communities. And that's where inequalities start arising. So, for example, when we just started, we started working with some activists in Jharkhand, and they learned to use the system very quickly, and they started encouraging people to record grievances and so on, which they could then take up. But what we also saw at the same time was that many people who were new to using phones or new to sort of recording messages were not able to record them properly. Right? So they need some practice, they need some, you can call it training, you can call it more exposure on how to articulate what they want to say. So we started noticing that many of our volunteers at that time would discourage them from recording messages on their own. They would say, you tell us and we will record it on your behalf. But we wanted to democratize it so that we ultimately that's sort of been the whole vision behind Grama Needs, so that these systems become embedded in the community. It's not that we want to work through intermediaries who represent others, because then many other problems arise because of that. So that was a big realization. And we then had to work very hard. It was new for us in the sense that we were not exposed to thinking on these lines. So it was sort of new, and we grew our team. We got people who had a lot of experience in community mobilization and management. So all of that was very useful. So for example, we had to ensure that among our volunteers themselves, we had a lot of class and caste-based diversity, because that's when the volunteers are able to reach out to the communities, inform them about what this platform is and encourage them to use it. Because that's how the Indian society is. I mean, it is a divided society at the end of the day. So you need that representativeness to ensure equity. Similarly, when it comes to women, one is many of us might be aware of what we call the digital gender divide, that women typically get the hand-me-down phones. Right, so if a household is to purchase a phone, first the husband gets it, and the women might have access to it in the evenings, or they get the older model. So naturally, therefore, their ability to use the phones and skills are limited because of that. Plus, how do we even reach women in the first place if we have men volunteers? The society doesn't, at least in North India, in the areas like Bihar and UP, MP, where we've been working, that's not considered socially appropriate for men to be interacting with, reaching out to women and telling them about the platform and so on. So we had to work with women volunteers. We wanted to identify women volunteers, but women are so busy. They have to do so much work in the home. They have to manage. Many of them have to take up agriculture work because many of the men migrate to cities for work. So therefore, even to reach women, to even inform them about this platform, encourage them to use it, none of that was easy. So now we've developed many methods, but this is just to say that there's a lot of inherent inequities in society, and those get reflected when it comes to technology access, let's say. And therefore, you have to take some very deliberate steps to make sure that you don't amplify those inequalities, you don't reproduce those inequalities. Because otherwise, what you would get is that only young men users would be using mobile money, and nobody else would feel comfortable in using it. They would feel excluded. So you have to take specific steps to ensure that kind of representativeness. So in the same way, there's many such challenges. I've mentioned about this inclusion challenge. Mobile money is ultimately a social media participatory media platform. So pretty much the challenges we see today of misuse with misinformation, disinformation. It was very interesting that we actually never got that problem on mobile money. And partly it was because the platform has been moderated from the beginning. So it's not that you can say anything and it will get published. It goes through the moderation process. And in our moderation process, we've always followed an editorial policy that encourages diversity. So this has sort of been a principle that has gotten ingrained among all the users as they start interacting with mobile money, because then a view of the opposition is sort of not seen as antagonistic, but it is seen more as yet another viewpoint on which you can engage. So there are many examples that we have. So mobile money is used very actively for local discussions on local issues. For example, if there's a strike of teachers, it's used by teachers to talk about why they're striking. It's used by parents to complain. It's also used by government officials. And in fact, we bring some of these comments in ourselves. So our volunteers, they go to meet government officials and they encourage them to record. So it's used by government to get a view of the government also, that why is this strike happening? Is it valid? Is it not valid? So it basically, because it's used by a diverse set of stakeholders, we're able to provide diverse information, but it's not viewed as in any antagonistic manner by the people that I would want to misuse it. So really people see that it's a useful medium. It's helps solve problems for them. So very much like a commons-based philosophy for that matter, that people want to preserve the sanctity of the place. They want to protect it from misuse. So again, these are essentially, you can say that there were some design choices as we went along, plus very active policies of management of the platform that we adhered to, so that there was very little misuse of the sort that we typically see on social media. Similarly, even with trying to work with volunteers, so we run workshops regularly with volunteers so that we train them on what are the different government schemes, what sort of problems arise on these government schemes, and how can you help resolve these problems for the people? Who are the right? What's the right government office to go to for which kind of problem? So all of these were things that we had to learn and develop as we went along to ensure that the platform leads to impact and it doesn't get misused and it doesn't increase inequalities any further. So that was basically why I said that it's not just a simple thing that you build the technology and that's it. But it requires continuous steering, continuous learning, and based on which we have to keep managing and handling the problems.
Right. Yeah, I think very good points. So does this also have implications for the wider area of technology in general, social media, the big social medias, based on your experience with Gramani?
These principles are very, very generic in that sense. I mean, the learnings that we've had through Gramani are sort of not unique to Gramani. So many of my colleagues and other friends who are running social enterprises and other people who are working more in the research space of, so broadly there's this very, so the research area under which we club such work is called ICTs for development. information and communication technologies for development. So some of these principles have been realized, and they go on to explain why we see many problems also with other technologies that have been deployed in similar contexts. So for example, if you take Aadhaar, for example, and its use in direct benefit transfers. So while on the one hand, it's great that now there's a automated way of authenticating people. It's meant to be inclusive because people don't know, need to know how to read and write. They can just use the biometrics. There's less chances of corruption because the money will come directly to the bank accounts instead of being routed via intermediaries. So in theory, I mean, it's great, and we've seen many successes, of course, also. But my point, just like with the examples I gave of Grahamani, is that it also needs management, careful thought and thoughtful management to ensure that there's no exclusions. So with Aadhaar, for example, we know that biometrics do fail, and then people don't have any easy recourse. If the biometric fails, the ration dealer just sends them back, even though there's a Supreme Court order that that's not how it's supposed to be. But on the ground, it's hard to impose any such issues. Similarly with bank payments, there have been many issues of Aadhaar accounts, Aadhaar numbers being linked with the wrong bank account, and purely because of data entry errors. Right, so somebody sitting there who's typing the bank account number, ultimately somebody is entering that data into an electronic system, and you can make mistakes. And that means that now if you've done work in a scheme like Narega and you've not gotten paid, right? So just imagine, right? I think we are all privileged people. We work in MNCs, we work in companies. Now, if you do your work and your company doesn't pay you, I mean, you're going to raise a hue and cry. But we are talking about millions of people who are doing very hard manual labor, and then their wages are delayed, their wages go to the wrong bank account, or they don't come to the bank account, plus they don't even come to know, right? So there are many such challenges with this government-to-citizen interface, where the introduction of technology has been useful, but it has left out many people, and there are no clean ways for them to fix the problem. So that is what is very hard. It violates the rights of people, and authorities are accountable by law for many of these violations, but there is not very serious efforts being put on that. So in the same way, I mean, there are many such cases, right? I mean, any technology, when it interfaces with society, it does lead to places where there will be failures. But the point is that how do we handle these failures? Is it really empowering people, or is it leading to disempowerment? So just like, I mean, another example would be in terms of how the design of the technology itself can be disempowering, right? So if you think about Uber, now, ultimately, it's great that it's aggregating drivers. It's also giving them source of employment. There's so much of foreign investment coming in. So you've just expanded the market. Now you've given loans so that there can be more cars on the roads, and all that is fantastic. But ultimately, the drivers are under algorithmic control, right? It's algorithms dictating what the drivers are supposed to do, who to go, where to go. But there is very little grievance redressal or accountability channels for the drivers to give their view, right? So there are many such cases where the drivers have been abused by consumers, but there are no, I mean, they can't even talk to Uber in that way to raise some of these issues. Plus, of course, I mean, I'm sure we'll all be familiar with issues of wages and incentives that Uber and other companies have introduced, but which then don't get passed on, the profits don't get passed on to the drivers. So there are many such issues, but technology can be very empowering, but at the same time, all of these corner cases, failure cases, they need to be, you can't leave them out, basically.
So a lot more thought needs to be put into the design of any technology. It will always have social implications.
Yeah.
Good point. So the pandemic over the last 1 year, and the associated lockdowns, they've led to a host of issues, livelihood issues, food insecurity, healthcare access. Can you talk about Gramvani's work on providing relief during the pandemic over the last 1 year? Looks like we've lost Ayatheshwar. Pratmesh, are you able to hear me? Okay, let's wait for Adi to join in. Call Adi and see. Hey guys, you're able to hear me, right? Okay. Sorry, guys. Adi is just trying to rejoin.
So we're looking to get Adi Teshwar back on the stage, right?
Yeah. He's trying to rejoin.
Okay. IIT Delhi ka bhi internet barbaad hai.
Cool. I can hear you. Achha, so did I get was I the one who got disconnected?
Yeah, it looks like. Yeah.
Achha. Joke
banaya ki IIT Delhi ka internet shayad thoda barbaad.
Wo to pure sabhi har jagah ki kahani hai. Achha, but I baki to matlab my otherwise I was able to access but yeah, we can.
Yeah. So I don't know if you heard my last question, right? So I think what I was saying is the pandemic has led to a lot of livelihood issues, food insecurity, and that is some of the areas that Gramvani has also worked over the last 1 year. Can you talk about the pandemic response of Gramvani?
Yeah. So the team actually was able to give a very solid, very effective response right from the last year. By the end of March when the lockdown started. So the good thing was that, so like I said, that Gramvani, the whole philosophy has been that these platforms are embedded in the community. And we have, other than the IVR platform, we also have a strong team of volunteers on the ground. The volunteers come from the same community, and some of them have been with us for more than 6-7 years. And they're well acquainted with other local NGOs in the area. They're connected with government administration and other stakeholders in the area. So they were really instrumental because, so when the lockdown, last year, for example, when the lockdown started, there was immediate issues of access to food and access to cash where people needed help. Similarly, we've also been working in Delhi NCR with migrant workers. So here, of course, I'm sure all of you know about the issues that they faced because they were suddenly out of work. They couldn't step out of their rooms there. So they all stay in rented rooms, like 4 or 5 people stay in one room. They weren't allowed to venture out. And they didn't have food. They didn't have cash, nothing. So the platform became one way where they were able to call and put in a request for help. And we were able to connect with many organizations. So in Delhi, for example, we were working with organizations like Gurgaon Nagrik Ekta Manch and Safe in India, who were trying to provide food kits to migrant workers. Similarly, in rural areas, we were networked with many other local NGOs and others running community kitchens, and also with the local sarpanch and other people. So we got requests from like visually impaired people, senior citizens who couldn't venture out, and in general, poor communities, poor basties. And we were able to relay these requests and get help for the people. Similarly, I spoke about the help that volunteers are able to provide in helping ensure access to social entitlements and social protection. So the government provided some cash transfer schemes, but again, for reasons that I was talking about earlier, many people did not get their cash transfers. So these were Jandhan transfers, pension transfers, PM Kisan transfers, and other things like double ration that they were entitled to. And it was all linked to various like issues, things like ration dealers not working properly. Later on, once the lockdown relaxed and NREGA was opened up, there was a huge demand for NREGA because all other sources of livelihood were out, especially for migrant workers who had by now come back. So NREGA was their only source of employment. But again, here all the systems were working very slowly. So the platform was able to serve a very strong social accountability role.
Looks like the connection is lost again. Folks, are you able to hear me? Okay, looks like IIT Delhi internet is a problem.
Before we get Aditya back, right? So, why don't you, based on the interactions which you have had with Aditya, you can just build on what was.
So what I understand is, I think a couple of things I can comment on it because I was involved in some of those efforts as well. Is the widespread presence of the mobile money platform, which marginalized communities can tap into and put their SOS calls. Right? So that was one thing that some of us from the IITK alumni network got together and we worked with the various stakeholders that Grahamani was already working with to raise funds and to initiate appropriate help. So this was something that has been, I think, for me, a good validation of the Mobile Money platform. And I've been able to reach out to hundreds of families via this platform in a very quick span of time. So these includes I can go into some more details here, right? So I think a couple of things are food is a big issue. The public distribution system coverage is very less in India, especially for migrant workers who may have ration cards, but they are not entitled to the amount of food that they would have gotten back in their villages in the cities. Right? So they are completely dependent on that. Livelihood becomes a big issue, especially during lockdowns. So cash transfers are the need of the hour. And there is a lot of misinformation. I think, as Aditya mentioned, a lot of these platforms, the big social media platforms, can also engender a lot of misinformation regarding vaccines. I think we've seen a lot of vaccine misinformation. So Mobile Vani has also been running information campaigns to address those. And
okay.
Looks like Kalteshwar is back.
Yeah, hi. Sorry, I should know what's happening. My network seems to be fine. I'm able to access other things, but
no problem. So I was just filling in with the work that we had done with the alumni network.
Yeah.
I'm doing the same question on COVID relief. Do you want to add anything else? Maybe I think we got some questions. So let's start with the questions, and then we'll come back to how folks can help.
Sure. Yeah.
All the technologists here can help in social development. Right? So yeah. One question I'll start with is also interestingly on policy. What are the implications of this work in terms of appropriate technology and public policy?
So I think one broad point, of course, is which I was saying that, I mean, any sort of a technology that we do for any G2C, government-to-citizen systems or in general, right, it has to consider the socio-technical interface, right? When people start using it, then what kind of issues can arise? And the main principle for dealing with this is essentially just to be very actively listening to what's happening on the ground, right? What challenges are people facing? And then to quickly react to those challenges. So I think in many systems which are adopted at very large scales, very often it's done without having done proper pilots. So in the haste of putting something out, you typically launch like a very large scale intervention, large scale system, and then it leads to exclusions, but you've not set up the processes for dealing with these failure cases. So essentially, I think that's the main principle of continuously listening, hearing what's happening, where is it failing, and then trying to course correct. Ideally, of course, do that before you launch. So start with pilots and in diverse areas so that there is some knowledge beforehand of what can go wrong and you've already adjusted for these things. Yeah.
And yeah, I think that's a very good point because you're also listening the feedback from the ground. In a way, policy can be built bottom up with bottom up feedback, which is critically missing in India.
Right. Exactly. So there's been some interesting things that people, many organizations have started working actually with Grahamani to use the platform's capability basically to listen to what's going wrong. So that's been interesting that. Platforms like Grahamani can also play a role in providing this bottom-up feedback on how things can be improved.
Another question that we have here is, and folks, please please type in your questions on the chat window. We will take them one by one. How does being a social entrepreneur feels personally, and how challenges are different than a commercial enterprise, and how the constant social pressure of commercially industrially successful is overcome constantly during work?
So I actually don't think there's much of a difference. I think both commercial or social ventures, right, we go through the same sets of challenges of ensuring cash flow, pivoting to whenever what's working, what's not working. Ultimately, I mean, commercial ventures are driven that are they providing value to the customer? So what's the market fit, so to say? And in the same way, right, in the social sector, you use terms like sustainability, that if you were to go, would people still want your intervention, right? So it's the same thing, right, of essentially finding that need that you're fulfilling, and that need is actually a felt need by the community. So in that sense, I think both are very similar. In some ways, the social sector is a bit harder because you need to also ensure financial sustainability. But here you're working in an environment where people have very little disposable income. So that is why there are all sorts of different models that typically, if people are not able to pay and they need a free service, then in our case at Gramani, for example, we try to fill in that by hosting advertisements. So that's one of the revenue models for us. That companies that want to work in rural areas, expand to rural areas, they can run advertisements on the platform. Then we also work with research organizations who want to conduct research studies, or with even governments who want to run information campaigns. So it's in some sense we're providing, it's very much like a Facebook model for us, that we're providing a free service to users, but we're running the company through this B2B kind of a revenue. I wouldn't say there's much of a difference. I think both require equal amount of hard work, persistence, figuring out how to get it right.
Okay, great. So the next question was on the revenue model. So I think you've answered that. I don't know if you want to add anything more to that. So the question was revenue model and how has this venture been made sustainable?
I mean, that's one of the models. And so Pradeep has also asked that how do you share your platform and work with other NGOs? So actually that's another revenue model, in the sense that many organizations are actually using our technology and overall model for their own work. So like I talked about physically disempowered people using it. So that's actually, it's a project which is run by an organization called Enable India. They run the platform in the same way other organizations are using it. And so the labor unions, for example, are using it, and similarly other. So in that case, our revenue model is more of a services-oriented business, that we provide the platform and some of the training on how to use the platform as a service to other organizations. So that's yet another model.
Yeah. Okay. The next question is, how to use technology to teach children with special needs? How can parents use technology to help their children?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great question. Specific to Gramvani, we've seen some interesting, we worked with organizations like Sesame Workshop, which, so you might see on TV, there's this program called Gali Gali Sim Sim for small children, and they teach things like numeric literacy and even civics, sanitation, hygiene kind of practices. So we've done some of these projects where the platform was used more as a way to engage parents and to tell parents on what kind of activities they can do with their children. So that's one of the models, that how can we make parents more active participants in the education of their children, and communication can serve one of a role over here. But then there's many other, I mean, there's so many fantastic organizations doing a lot of work in this space. so there's another organization called Dost Education that I know about, who create similar activity modules for parents. There's an exciting project going on at Microsoft Research in Bangalore, which works with visually impaired kids to teach computational thinking. So so this is again a very interesting area, that how do you so there's this new theme on computational thinking of getting kids to think more algorithmically, so that they can chalk out a procedure, run it step by step, think about programmatic structures like loops, and then how do you get visually impaired kids to also learn similar things? So Microsoft Research Bangalore has built these interesting toys, which so the kids can just feel them with their hands, and they're able to put things together and learn how some of these operations can be performed. So lots of interesting things, definitely.
Okay. One more question we have is, one of the greatest problems in the information sector is that labor is not documented. What is the possibility of Gramvani to document labor, given the context of invisible migrant labor to the government?
Yeah, so that's actually, yeah, I mean, it's a great question, because so what we mean by invisible labor essentially is that because there's a lot of unorganized sector work in India, most of the employment is actually in the informal sector, which means that neither is the employer in any database as such, nor is the employer to employee kind of a relationship anywhere available. So most of the transactions are also in cash, for example. Therefore, what that means is that if there are any benefits to be given to people, so if for workers, for example, there are many social protection schemes, right? There's maternity benefits that they should get. There's accident insurance. There's provident fund as a social security for old age. So there are many, many such schemes. But ultimately, all of these schemes become accessible only when you're a documented worker. And then there are other associated requirements, like there needs to be a proof of employment and so on. So can the question basically is that, can technology play a role? Probably, right? I think that's the main question. Yeah, I mean, yes and no, in the sense that technology can definitely, I mean, you can imagine that if there are such systems, then, and which are easily accessible, so workers can put in a request. I mean, they can put in their details, their work documentation, but ultimately it also has to be accessible to the people. It also has to be acceptable by the government. So there's work required on both sides, both on technology development, which is accessible to the workers, but also on the policy side, the policy is going to accept proof of employment which has been put in by such systems.
So do you want to talk about how technologies can contribute to social development, right? I think we have talked about you know, the way to think about technology with the social. Do you have some concrete steps and ideas how people can collaborate, think, and maybe collaborate with you as well?
Great. Some of the things we're trying to do is we're thinking of trying to set up a center for responsible technologies and appropriate technologies at IIT Delhi. And one of the goals of the center would be to bring in talent. People who can even provide voluntary help to build technologies. And what the center will really try to do is to bring in requirements. By connecting with civil society organizations, NGOs, even governments, in terms of what are some interesting, relevant technologies that can be built, and then to put up those requirements so that we can use some engineering talent to build these technologies. And of course, I mean, what we've talked about all through this evening has really been that just building the technology itself is not enough. So one of the other goals that the center will try to serve is to also keep bringing out what problems are happening so that the technology design and management can be refined continuously. So that's something, I mean, it's still in the works. But if you're interested, I think we can start even now. So if anybody is interested, just feel free to drop me an email, and we'll connect it with many organizations who would be very interested to participate. So that's one of the things. But even otherwise, I think some of the points are that we also want to be able to provide insights that wherever you might be working, if your technologies ultimately are being used by people, what problems are they facing? And if we can provide the necessary findings from the ground, then that can be a way for technologists to connect with society, so to say. So we want the center to really be that bridge between technologists and society, so that the technology design can be more thoughtful, it can be more appropriate, more responsibly done, and as well as it can be done for needs which ultimately benefit the people. Plus, I'll also make a plug for Gramani that we're also looking for software engineers pretty much at all levels, at the fresher, mid-level, senior level. So if anybody is interested, please let us know. We're trying to expand our team. So that's another thing.
There was a question on financing the initial cost of livelihood projects. I'm not sure what the question means. Do you want to take it up, Adi? Or if I would put the question to elaborate on it on the chat window.
I think probably what the question was trying to ask is that how do we jumpstart projects, right? So I think that's a common issue, that if somebody has a new idea, how do they start? How do they get funding to start? So I mean, there's no one answer. I think the good thing is in India now, this area is being recognized more and more. Of trying to build the whole area of social entrepreneurship in general, and also use of technology. And there are many exciting incubators. So there's Vilgrow, there's another one called the Deshpande Sandbox. Central Square Foundation also works on education projects. So all of these essentially encourage, they're like incubators. So they help you develop the idea, test it, flesh it out. And then they also put you in touch with funders, donors, who can help put some of it into action. So that's one way. But I think on a case-by-case basis, I mean, there's many large organizations who are doing very good stuff. So another way can really be to think of it like an intrapreneurial venture to work in incubating it within some of these large organizations and then to scale it up. So,
those
are some of the ways that I've seen.
So, Pratik is asking a question. Can this be used as a means of primary education, especially in rural areas? Teachers can dictate and present their lessons on the IVRs.
Yeah. So, actually, we've seen a bunch of projects that many of our partners have been working on with this same idea. Putting out lesson plans and then kids being able to listen to it over IVR and also ask questions, which can then be answered by the teachers. It has worked to some extent, but then I'll also say that it's limited, right? Because there's no visual interface. So ultimately, I think it is a big problem. What was basically called the education emergency. Because kids have been out of school for more than a year, and there's been a lot of missed opportunity of continued education, and I think it's not an easy problem to solve, because I mean the digital divide is so stark. So many people, I think we've all been reading all these reports. It's not really new information, but I mean access to smartphones, good quality internet, right? It's not there. Especially in poor households, they maybe just have one phone at most, which is shared. So kids really don't have that access. And then it's not easy. I mean, livelihood and other things have been impacted so badly that it's not even easy for them to buy like separate dedicated phones for children. So I think it's a big issue. IVR can fill in the gap to some extent, but again, it's not a complete solution. So this really, I mean, as a policy, I think the education space needs a lot of thought. We've actually not seen much happening. No interesting proposals or suggestions. I think it's a big gap. So if anybody has good ideas, I think there'll be a lot of room for that.
There was one comment on guidance mentoring for Seva Smart Eco Village Association.
That I am not familiar with this.
Yes, if the person is here, can you please add more questions, add more clarification on that? And if there are more questions, I think Adi, you'll be available for a few more minutes, right?
Yeah.
So we can extend this beyond the 1 hour. If there are more questions, you know, we can take those. Okay, I think no more questions are coming.
Okay, Aditeshwar, I will ask one question.
Yeah, sure.
What is the level of control you guys have been able to exert on influencing policy? I mean, an honest answer, right? So we all want policy to be conducive, and policy has to be conducive to bring a good changes which we want to see. And things are often slow, right? And often we try to push things, but on ground things are slow, right? So what is the level of control we have actually gotten in terms of influencing policy, and how do we think this can become better, or how do we increase our influenceability?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. So speaking about Grahamani specifically, we have done very good advocacy at the local level. So what that means is at the local level, trying to make sure that like in Narega, the Rozgar Divas, which is meant for assisting people to demand work to get job cards for some of this work. Those Rozgar Divas happen regularly. Similarly, in other things like ensuring quality of midday meals in schools, quality of take-home rations that are given by Anganwadi centers. So I think we've done a very good, but not so much in terms of the policies for influencing policies for like e-governance solutions or how direct benefit transfer can be improved and so on. So here, Grahamani has now literally started working more with research organizations. And we have put up a few representations on some of these things, including some new proposals by the government, like in the something called the Agri-Stack, which has been proposed, and even registration for migrant workers. So I think Grahamani is getting there, but in a broader sense, I think there is a strong voice in the civil society. There are many strong campaigns like the Right to Food campaign, Working People's Charter, many such ground level campaigns, which do put up a lot of representation for better policy design for technology. But what is probably missing is that very often these representations may not be taken into account. So that is a gap. And again, I think that is something where even the alumni network can play a role for that matter. Because ultimately, I think the IIT group will have a strong standing. I think if we can join in some of these policy petitions, policy recommendations, it will be very helpful. Just going back to what I was talking about as one of the roles of this center that we are trying to create, it can serve as a way to just acquaint everybody much better with the ground realities. Because very often these ground realities are not represented in the media. And partly because of that, none of us really have a voice in the policy. So I think I'd be very excited to think and work with the Alumni Association and everybody on some of this so that we can have a way to bring in ground realities and take support from the association in building a better representation on some of these policy issues. That would be a very strong impact, I think.
Yeah. I think Sarthak has asked one question. Yeah, Vikram.
So there is a question from Sarthak. You began this, what was your drive behind this? Was it a particular incident that made you spend Gramani? And what's your personal mission that you've been able to achieve via Gramani?
Yeah, very honestly, Sarthak, actually Vikrant and other friends from IIT have a strong role to play. Mitesh, Harsh, Aditya, Guru. So I mentioned this right in the beginning. We've been going on, we used to go on treks. And very honestly, that was really the time when it really hit me about when we were trekking in these remote areas and there was no internet, nothing. And this is like many, many years back also. So that was really the initiation of the idea. But I was also very, very fortunate that it was during my PhD and I had a very supportive PhD supervisor who was very helpful. So he helped flesh out these ideas. He helped convert it into like technical problems which you can solve during your research. So it was all of these things coming together, just observations in general, the contrast that you see and it hits you at times. And then a lot of conversations with NGOs and civil society organizations in India, which really helped me understand more about what were some of these issues. And help me understand the relevance that information and media can play in some of this.
One question from my side, how do you think, looking into the future, how do you scale up Gramani's model, right? How do you take these participatory media, increase the adoption across India in places where it's where this flow of information is top to down? How do we scale it up in these places to allow people to reverse the flow of information?
Yeah. I think on the good side, the digital penetration is increasing quite a bit. So until now, we were a bit limited in our reach because we were restricted to using IVR systems because people didn't have internet. And with IVR, one of our biggest cost components is the call cost because we are paying the call cost, the users, so that the users get a free service. But with increasing digital penetration, I think that's going to get easier for us. So we are actually now also moving to delivering the same kind of services, but using WhatsApp, Facebook Messenger, and then we also have an app. So that's some of the models that we're thinking about, that people who may not need to use IVR, but if they have a smartphone, they're on WhatsApp. So through that itself, they can interact, they can put in grievances, right? So the same model can basically work. It's just that the channel becomes, the communication channel becomes different. Another strong point with our whole model is that it is community centric. So we want to scale community by community, because we also want to make sure that we have strong volunteers on the ground who can act upon many of the points that we are, people are raising. So over there, we're thinking of working more closely with the youth networks. So this was actually something new that came up actually during this, the last wave itself, where we saw a lot of engagement by youth in helping people with, organize vaccination sessions in the villages, helping in general with emergency transport. So there was a very high degree of energy that we saw, and a commitment by young people to help their community. So that's the other part to it, of also that while we can scale the technology more easily, but we also need to scale the offline intervention at the same time. And that's where hopefully working with some youth networks will be useful.
Great, great.
So I believe we can wrap this up now. Okay. So before we wrap this up, I'll ask just one question to Aditeshwar. What is one single incident from IIT Kanpur or single memory, which you think has made you built you?
I think it's really just the energy which we saw with each other, I think that has been very special. So I think so one of the common passwords in Gramani, and I'm divulging the password. So one of the common passwords is Junoon. And so on many of our, I mean, now, of course, I hope our team has put in stronger passwords and variations of Junoon. But for a long time, this used to be a key password. So I think that Junoon and obsession comes from, you know, the whole atmosphere and setup that we have at IIT. It's really a drive, I think, that all of us have in trying to do good in whatever activities we take up. And this word Junoon also actually came from a senior, Gautam Gupta, Gagu. So he, Junoon was his password. And then I sort of stole that. And so I think that's, I give complete credit to the IIT environment for sort of driving and making us all like, such obsessive creatures. So that's really definitely helped in, just staying the course.
Yeah, cool.
There's one last question from Shivani. We can take this question. Deploy Gramvani in improving the employment of homemakers by helping them in building cooperative businesses by providing them insights into business models?
Great question, Shivani. We have actually, there's a very strong movement and push on women entrepreneurship, both in rural areas as well as in the setting that you're suggesting, homemakers who can also devote some time to income generation. So ultimately, I think it's a communication platform, right? And in that sense, a communication platform can fit in into pretty much any space. Giving out tips on and do's and don'ts on setting up your own business, and asking for support. We've had some done some good projects also in this. In this space where women who've taken loans from microfinance institutions to set up their own enterprise, then what sort of things should they take care of to manage cash flow, to build customers, to sort of get a marketing kind of a feel to run their small enterprises, whatever they might be, tea stalls or anything.
Okay.
So, Prithmesh, will you be able to send an email to all the people who have registered? You know, we can summarize some of these points.
Yes. And the recording of this session would also be posted on our social media handle, YouTube channel. Okay. So, yeah. So, thanks, Aditeshwar. Thanks, Vikram. And, thanks to all the audience who asked, and especially those who asked questions and made this fireside chat lively. Thanks to Alumni Association, Bangalore Chapter Management Committee. Special thanks to Lokesh Sharma, who is the main organizer of LM Cafe Series. We wishing everyone safe stay, and hope you had some great takeaways from today's session. In case of any follow-ups, and we do encourage all different kinds of follow-ups, and the intention of organizing all these sessions is to foster interaction. So thanks, Aditeshwar, for posting your email address. Looking forward towards good takeaways from this session and good the post session follow-ups. And stay tuned. We would be organizing more such sessions and on other different interesting topics. Thank you all, and we are closing to this today's session.
Okay. Thanks everybody. Thanks Prathmesh. Thanks Lokesh, and especially thanks to Vikrant for pulling all this together and for planning it so wonderfully.
Thanks,
it was a lot of fun interacting and chatting about all this. Great.
Bye.